Joan of Arc is a scenario-based board game of medieval battle and exploration set during the Hundred Years' War. The core of the game are the historical accounts of that period. However, these are accounts from the medieval perspective and include real events like the werewolf hunt of la Croix du Loup Pendu in 1383. We have chosen to include these myths and legends as if they were all literally true, so werewolves, unicorns, angels, demons, and dragons are all possible. Each time you play Joan of Arc, you have the choice to play either tactical scenarios, reliving famous battles and historical events, or mythical scenarios, exploring the myths and nightmares of the medieval times. Each game of Joan of Arc follows the story set out in a specific scenario. Scenarios are written for varying numbers of players from 1 to 4, with 2 players being the most common. Each scenario has its own way of setting up the hexagons that will make up the game board. It also lists the characters, troops, creatures, and civilians who have a part in telling the tale. Importantly, combat is not usually the only route to victory in Joan of Arc. Depending on the scenario, a player may need to explore the map, talk to the locals, or battle the enemies, sometimes all 3. In addition to the many scenarios, Joan of Arc also has a battle mode option, which lets you face your opponent in open battle. Choose a battle size, build your army, and head out into one of the many different maps to eliminate your foes, control strategic areas, or assassinate your opposing general. To play a game, players first decide on a scenario. This will tell them how to set up the game board and which forces each player has. The game board is made up of hexagonal tiles, or hexes, that are each divided into 1, 2, or 3 areas. Each player has a board to hold their current orders and tokens. Next to this, they will place a reference card for each type of unit under their control. Every game of Joan of Arc features a battle board, which is used by all players to draw cards, manage wounded units, and organize each round. Cards in the Round, War Council, Legend, and Discussion decks are shared by all players. These are placed on or next to the battle board, along with pools of spare orders and tokens. The miniatures used for each unit are shown on the artwork of the unit card. Units in your forces can range from legendary characters to military troops, holy angels to devilish demons, iconic historical figures to gigantic mythical creatures. Joan of Arc is played in rounds. A round starts with the council phase, and then each player has 1 turn in sequence. When all players have taken their turn, the round ends and a new one begins. During the council phase, a new round card is revealed. This tells the players how many gray command orders they each get for that round. Then, 3 war council cards are turned over to form this turn's river. Each player then chooses one of the war council cards in the river and takes the benefit on that card. Several players may choose the same card. The benefits of the War Council cards vary. They can give a player additional orders, allow them to exchange the resources they already have, or offer some other benefits such as healing wounds or drawing legend cards. The final step of the council phase is to pay for any upkeep each player has. For each level 2 character they own on the game board, a player must spend 1 experience token. If they cannot or choose not to upkeep a level 2 character, the character will revert back to level 1. Once all players have completed their upkeep step, play moves to the first player's turn. The first part of a player's turn is the orders phase. Here they spend their orders to activate units on the board. Unlike many games, units are not activated individually. Instead, orders are played into an area, and all units in that area may activate to move, attack, or wait. Whenever a character is in an activated area, bonus actions will also be available, such as recruiting civilians, starting discussions, commanding your army's troops, upgrading a character, or using equipment. Each area can usually be activated only once per player turn. However, individual units may activate more than once if they move into new areas which are activated later. This makes the sequence of activations critical. For example, a player places an order in an area and activates a unit to move into a second area. If an order was then spent on this second area, the unit would be activated a second time. All orders can be used to activate units in areas. However, each also comes with their own unique ability. The different types of orders are as follows. Gray command orders allow characters with command value to activate troops in range of their command. This can be used to maneuver or regroup your forces. Green charge orders can be used to trigger the charge skills for any units in the area they are spent in. Typically, this allows cavalry or fast-moving infantry to move and attack in the same activation. Yellow reactivation orders can be played in an area that already contains an order. This allows the same area to be activated twice in the same turn. Blue interrupt orders are the only orders which can be played during an opponent's turn. Using an interrupt between your opponent's orders can really upset an enemy's plans if played at the right moment. Players may spend any or all of their orders, or save some for future turns, but must always play at least one order per turn. Alongside orders, there are also resources such as experience, legend, and intrigue tokens. These tokens are gained by completing certain goals outlined in the scenario setup. Experience tokens can be spent to upgrade your characters, pay for upkeep, trigger powers, and with various War Council cards. Legend tokens are used to trigger cards drawn from the Legend deck. Each time you play a scenario, you will use either the Tactics Legend deck for historical and tactical scenarios, or the Myth Legend deck for mythical and fantastical scenarios. This means that you can draw thematic and exciting legend cards tailored for each scenario type. Intrigue tokens can be gained by using your characters to trigger discussions with civilians found in each scenario. Each civilian has unique discussion cards, which have a range of potential questions, conversation paths, and outcomes when you interact with them. Successfully gaining intrigue tokens can open up powerful and scenario-specific intrigue powers, designed to add flavor and strategy to your game. Movement is always into an adjacent area, unless a unit has a special rule such as charge. To start a discussion with a civilian, you must move a unit into their area. You then choose a discussion card at random, and your opponent reads out potential questions you can ask the civilian. Once you decide what to say to them, your opponent will tell you how they react. It's not always how you expect. In these times of war, combat is inevitable. Each unit has a number and color of dice to roll for both attack and defense. The four colors of dice have different combinations of results on them, and range from lethal to highly defensive. To resolve combat, simply roll the attack or defense dice and compare the results. Units can be pushed back, suffer wounds, or be killed outright. Those who have been wounded rather than killed are placed into the infirmary. At the end of each round, players will roll the doom dice for each wounded unit to see if they die from their wounds or recover and rally to the battlefield. Victory goes to whichever player fulfills their objective first. Sometimes this will mean killing a specific enemy. Other times it will mean getting the wagons of loot to the castle gates safely, or simply surviving until nightfall. Each scenario is different and will test your skills to their utmost. So, who will you fight for? France or England? Angels or demons?